Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Saturation Point by Adrian Tchaikovsky, narrated by Emma Newman. Chapter 1. Session 1. They asked me, "When was the last time you saw Dr. Fell?" And the memory hole I tripped into was ridiculous. After all this time. 20 years. I mean, I've moved on. I should have moved on. I haven't. You get an idea of what your life is going to be. Postgrad, impressionable age. And then it isn't how your life actually goes, but try telling your head that. In my head, I'm in the jungles of the zone still, doing what I studied for. Some part of me never left. 20 years. I wanted to tell them about the last day on site, after the money ran out and they pulled the plug on everything. Me and Dr. Fell in the last of the bubble tents, with the evac transporter grumble on the edge of hearing. Looking her in the eyes, sharing the guilt. How she just walked into the trees. That's my crystal clear recollection of it, 2 decades later. Just turned and walked into the trees. I dreamt it 12 times since. My mind is absolutely sure it happened. But I didn't say any of that, because I know it didn't go that way. She was on the same VTOL out of there that I was. You can't just walk into the trees in the zone. The trees will kill you. The zone will. In my memory, she's not even wearing her hazard suit. Memory is fallible. Dreams overwrite the reality. Fond fantasies inform the dreams. I've precious little evidence we were ever there, except for a redacted gap in my resume. She never let me in. I don't mean into the zone, I mean into the real stuff. My research was peanuts. They asked me what the big project was that Dr. Fell spent most of her time on, but I couldn't tell them. Ask her, I said, and they just looked at each other.
We'd love to, said Glasshauer, and Dr. Blake added, very quietly,
we think she went back in.
Now I'm going back in. Session 2. I'm already making a mess of this, of course. If this is going to be of any use, I need to start again. I'll delete the rest. Rambling recollections. No use to anyone. My name is Jasmine Marks. My name is Dr. Jasmine Marks. I'm a biologist contracted to Zeisheriton. Or I think I still am. I don't know what my status is, actually. I should check that. Session 3. I'm waiting for pickup now. I want to keep a journal like before. My track record with these isn't good, but I've set some reminders. I'm going to keep at it. After all, for the first time in decades, there'll actually be something worth recording that isn't crop yield stat analysis. I've already screwed up the start of this several times. I'll go back later and clean it all up. For now, I need to get this straight before I forget something important. I'm going back to the zone. They came to me when I was going over the plot 9 yield numbers. That's what Zeisheriton does with my education. One of a team of 6, building a better rice. Our most recent crop is doing well, actually. Shrugs off the new strains of Pyricularia grisea and has improved tolerance to high salt conditions. Not glamorous, but getting people fed. The top 3 patented brands of dry cultivation rice feed around 40% of the world's population, and that's the market we're aiming to break into. Really, it was looking encouraging. We were due a bonus. I gave that up, to be here, waiting in an echoing hangar for the plane to come take me south. It had better come. If this turns out to be a hoax, and they just dump me home with nothing to show for my time but 3 days to catch up on, then I'll... It was right after I broke for lunch, by which I mean, took my tablet out of the part of my flat that's my bedroom slash workroom
and boiled some noodles while I caught up on me time. By which I mean all the messages from my family about all the things they needed. I had 30 minutes before I had to log back in to show my supervisor I was working, and most of that was trying to eat noodles while talking to my aunt. Her side of the family is in a Morrison company town, built around one of their big distribution complexes. Cousin Bobby has a job there, but apparently this week it didn't come with any actual hours, and so he wasn't getting paid. Could I transfer value vouchers over to them so that they could get food from the company store? It wasn't the money, you understand. They had money. Aunt Charla was very proud of that. Suitcases of dollars they had. "I don't understand," she says. Aunt Charla is one of those people who take pride in not knowing about anything that's changed in the world in the last 30 years. "They wouldn't take notes. They wouldn't take cards. I showed them my balance. I'm in credit." "And you don't show your balance to people? That's how you get robbed," I tell her. And I know I'm going to have to explain the whole corporate value system to her again, and she won't listen. "They said there was rationing," she says, like she never heard of such a thing before. So I tell her that yes, there is rationing. Does she remember how they passed the bill? Right after that big storm and all the crop failures and the economy going south and all that? Apparently, Auntie Charla is completely blindsided by this. Like there weren't protests and shootings and the National Guard. And that leaves us trying to work out how I can transfer some of my Zeisheritan vouchers over into the Morrison system, so that Auntie Charla and my useless cousin Bobby and the rest of them can show that they're vicariously valuable enough to be allowed to buy some of what food there is. Which, needless to say, we don't get sorted, so I know that'll be my evening taken up. Except it's evening now and I'm not doing that. I asked Glasshauer to get his people to sort that for me, and suddenly I'm the sort of person who can say that and people say yes. I'm losing the thread here. I'm nervous. I'm sorry. I ignored the messages, because you get a lot of messages on the Zeisheritan channel, and most of them are junk. Internal admin junk and external advertising that inexplicably gets through all the filters. I just sat there and, you know, did my job for an hour, because they send you all this stuff and expect you to read it all and reply to it, except they don't actually budget any time for you to do that. So you end up trawling through it all after hours. Except then my line manager opens a window on my tablet. A shock to see a human face intruding into all my nice clean numbers. And I see the blue telltale that shows my own cameras come on. We stare at each other's naked faces awkwardly. It's horribly intimate and unexpected. "Jasmine," she says. "You have a meeting right now you should be at." All the usual. Sweats, plunging stomach. What have I forgotten? What did I get wrong? Am I fired? No good can come of an unexpected work meeting. Except when she flags up the request for me, it's not even Zeisheritan. External request, party by the name of Glasshauer. I protest. 3 words in, my line manager tells me to take it. Right now. On Zeisheritan's time. It's not actually Glasshauer. The window shows me a sharply dressed non-binary, very much the cutting edge of corporate chic right now. All about the job, not the gender, you know? The filter mask helps. Just about all I can say about them is they've got nice non-specific eyes. We go through some basic ID security to make sure I'm me, and then they tell my line manager she's surplus to requirements and cut her out of the call. I have had no opportunity to check any ID of theirs. They are, they tell me, Mr. Glasshauer's personal assistant. I have no idea who the hell Mr. Glasshauer is. He apparently knows who I am.
He wants to talk to me about the zone. It's been a long time since anybody wanted to talk about that. They tell me Glasshauer's cleared it with Zeisuritan. I get chapter and verse about how my esteemed employer's being compensated for my valuable time. A little screed of electronic handshakes and nods to say that I'm on secondment for the duration. Just an interview, I'm told. By the fact I'm waiting for the plane right now, you'll understand it wasn't just an interview. I mean, I'm used to people understating the amount of work involved in some project or other. They say an hour, and it'll be a day, you know. But this was a spectacular level of false advertising. And sure, I say, because what else? Breaks up the monotony of the day, right? Except right after, my spy hole system tells me there's someone at my door, at my actual apartment door. Even the mail and the takeout only gets as far as reception in my building. And it's not like I have anything to say to my neighbours, good home deskers as they all are. You'll have to excuse me, I tell the immaculate face of Mr. Glasshauer's personal assistant. I need to call building security. There's somebody at the door. The thought of the intrusion is making me sweat. Sweat more, anyway. I know, they tell me right back. It's me. The fuck? I say. And they neither flinch nor smile. And there they are in the camera on my door, standing in their neat little suit, out in the vomit green of the corridor, in my actual building. I could leave you to make your own way to Mr. Glasshauer's office, they tell me, but it would be easier if I just drove you to the airport. I say a lot of things like, drive me? And airport? But it boiled down to, your boss wants to meet me in person? Is he nuts? But they're already sending over all the stats. Air filtering and decontamination certificates for Glasshauer's offices, non-contagion check marks for all personnel, a clean corridor of guaranteed non-contact with any of the current wave of contagion variants. And of course, Zeisuritan will have handed over mine. Not like they need my permission. I get a mask on and open the door. There they are, large as life. Which is a little smaller than me, but still terrifying. A real live human being I never met before has cut through all the barriers that are supposed to exist between the great outdoors and my flat. I'm seeing them in the flesh. They're right there. They look me up and down. Maybe, they suggest, you want to get dressed. And I remember that I'm shirt and jacket above the waist and cargo shorts below, because my line manager's camera doesn't see that far, and because the AC in my building isn't worth shit. 5 minutes later, I'm dressed and in a climate-controlled car, coasting along half-empty roads to the airport. It's the first time I've met someone face-to-face, or left my apartment in 4 months. I sleep on the flight. It's a weird luxury. I get to sleep on company time that I'm actually being paid for. Makes a change from having to make sure I've touched a tablet screen every minute so they don't tell me I'm slacking off. When I wake up, I'm practically being poured from the plane into another car, one medically grade filtered AC system to another, and only a brief moment of heat in between. And it's a dry heat. That's not real heat, I know. When we get out of the car, it's in a cool underground garage, and then the lift, and then the office. In media, they still show these places with the glass walls and the real views, but these days, corporate money burrows deep, underground or into the centre of buildings, where you can properly control the temperature and light and humidity. Turning our backs on nature. Except, if that were true, they'd have no use for me. It's like I'm a shaman. A link to the past and the world beyond and the wilds, all in one. All three the same thing. I don't pass that particular revelation on to Mr. Glasshauer, though he might have appreciated it. He isn't what I've been expecting. So he's an old white guy, and that much is as expected. He's slouched at one end of a glass table, shirt open and no tie. A lot of lines about his eyes and mouth. I stare, don't come any closer than the other end of that long table, watch his lips tug like a smile.
They checked your bloods in the car, he points out,
and they had. That little needle jab built into the seat arm, just like any vehicle that carries multiple passengers.
And everyone in this building gets checked on entry. You can take your mask off.
There are always new variants, or straight up new diseases. I don't demask. He shrugs.
I leave it to your conscience.
It's fascinating, getting to stare at someone's face. Seeing all that moving flesh on a real person, not an actor, or some actors, a replica, more like. Except actors and their mocap proxies are all touched up to perfection, and Mr. Glasshauer, he's about to introduce himself, but it's him, is a man whose life experience is sketched in the lines about his mouth. All those smiles and frowns and pain and anger and satisfaction, written and overwritten until he's unreadable. His eyes twinkle. I reckon he hasn't slept in 48 hours at least. Dr. Fell used to get like that. Dr. Fell, concerning whom we're about to talk.
At least sit a little closer. I don't want to have to shout.
Then you should have just popped up in a window on my tablet screen and spared me all the travelling, is my thought about that. Probably it shows in my face, but that's the other benefit of masks, isn't it? Mulishly, I move halfway down the table, which seems to be enough.
Max, he says. Maxwell Glasshauer, Neosporin Threat Logistics.
A buzz from the slate in my pocket that means his credentials have just turned up on it. I open my mouth to say, Dr. Jasmine Marks, Zyshuritan Verdant Metrics, and he nods the words away.
The fact that you're here, he tells me, means I know who you are.
Watching my eyes for a reaction. 1,000 rejoinders bustle up inside me. About all this casual spook show intimidation. Yes, yes, and now you're going to tell me my mother's name and what I had for lunch, and... Except he might. I haven't heard of Neosporin. Who can keep track these days? But threat logistics sounds ominous. And I only hope I'm not part of the threat. The personal assistant comes back in then. I hadn't noticed they'd gone out. They bring in someone new, a woman, short and stocky, a mop of coarse, dark hair. Plenty of eyeliner, and as she pulls her mask down, plenty of makeup too. Utterly humourless. All the lines about eyes and mouth have been smoothed away with cosmetics, but I reckon she hasn't smiled or laughed since the womb, honestly.
Dr. Liz Blake, Dr. Jasmine Marks.
Glasshauer waves vaguely between us. The PAs absented themselves again.
Jasmine, Liz is our technical advisor on this project. Liz, Dr. Marks here is our expert.
The PA comes back in with coffee, either the real thing from one of the handful of places where it still grows, hence worth more than my annual bonus. Or just really good for Kawa. The timing is fortuitous, because if they had been 10 seconds earlier, I'd have spat mine across that nice clean glass table. Expert? I echo.
Blake looks at me as if I'm a fish that's gone off.
You were in the zone, she says,
like an accusation.
Please.
Glasshauer rolls his eyes.
Let's not have any of that Strugatsky BS. The Hygrometric Dehabitation Region. No point mystifying this business any more than we have to. But yes, Dr. Marks, you were in the HDR.
20 years ago, I say, when I was a grad student. Again, that tired smile from him, and he says,
well, officially, there's been no research presence since then, so we have to take what experts we can get. You were working under Elaine Fell. Why don't you tell us how that went?
I can't, I point out, and my pocket buzzes, and that's all the waivers from my former employer releasing me from the labyrinth of confidentiality clauses that have shackled me for 2 decades. Glasshauer makes an inviting gesture, and the pair of them settle back to listen. Which they do, for the next 2 hours, as the coffee comes and goes. At some point I take my mask off, because I understand that I am where the money is, and the AC will have the best filters and germ telltales, and I can actually sit there in the presence of 2 other human beings and not worry. And I worry because you can't just banish habits that easily. But I dare anyway. And that little act of rebellion, like I'm with 2 cool kids smoking in a high school drama, paves the way for what's to follow. For their part, they listen, and I know it's all being recorded. And surely most of what I have to say is in the records they've doubtless already cracked open and unredacted. They can get those waivers, they can definitely get hold of the formal write-up of Dr. Fell's work, both the stuff I was in on and the stuff I'm not supposed to know about. Or maybe that isn't in the records, because they ask me about it. My own experiences, what else was happening around me, where Dr. Fell got to when she wasn't in my eyeline. And I stumble to silence, because suddenly the whole thing's like an inquisition, with me as star witness. It was a long time ago, I try.
You still feel loyalty to her.
Glasshauer notes, with one of those sad smiles of his.
Speaks highly of your character, I assure you.
And I say they should ask her. I think I already said this part. I say that, and they say what they say, that Dr. Fell has gone back into the zone, despite everything.
Well then, she's dead, I say, looking for a denial in their faces.
Blake just stares back at me, as blank as if she's never heard the name of Elaine Fell before that second. Glasshauer shrugs.
Well, that's the real trick, isn't it? He suggests. Getting word out of the HDR, even knowing what she was doing in there. 19 of you came out. You are one of the few we've been able to speak to.
For a moment I feel a deathly clutch, thinking myself a character in a cheap thriller whose peers are being systematically silenced to protect a secret. Then I understand. Everyone else has a high-flying career that makes them too expensive or engaged in more important or confidential work. I'm just the dregs of the talent, the only one sufficiently for hire. It isn't as though Zyshuriton can't fill my shoes while I'm here in this expensive office.
Did you get on with Dr. Fell?
Blake asks. Well, obviously, she was principal investigator across all project sites. You had to. Blather, blather.
Did you get on with her?
And I think of all the arguments. Her demands for data that she'd never explain, the way the flow of information went only one way. Me saying, if I only knew why she wanted this or that, then I could be of more use. her bulldozing over me, determined that I should just be a cog in her invisible machine. She infuriated everyone. She trusted no one. She micromanaged one moment, left us to our own devices the next. I condense all this down for them best I can. Probably the rest of it comes over in my pauses and my tone. If I have ever met a real-life genius in my life, then it was Elaine Fell. Maddening genius. Genius that had no time to explain itself to an adoring student. I straight up refused to tell them anything more than, she was obviously working on something big. And I'd love to say it was out of fierce devotion to my long-ago mentor, but it's literally the extent of my knowledge. Something big. Some in-zone project that had been going on long before I ever turned up, wet behind the ears and fresh out of college. And somehow with a research placement in the most dangerous place on Earth. But I tell them everything in my best wide-eyed student way, which is coming over a bit strong, given I'm 40 now. And Glasshour lounges and nods, and Dr. Blake blinks, infrequently. And not one of us says the obvious thing, because none of us wants to commit it to the recording. That is, if Dr. Fell has gone back, then the big thing she was doing never stopped being done out there. Somehow, even after the deaths and the end of the funding, out in the zone, where it kills you.
If you were given access to your notes and other documents from the HDR research projects, how fast could you get up to speed?
Blake asks me. Well, I'd need time to, I start, and then she helpfully clarifies,
in hours?
But that's okay because it never left me. Because I have my own notes, absolutely prohibited under the terms of my contract, and I've gone over them more than once. The emergent ecosystems of the zone, not just surviving but thriving in the wreck of what we did to the place. I give them a small number. Neither of them bats an eyelid. They're used to people more naturally gifted than me, or else they know that, someplace in my head, I never left the zone. Make a list, Glasshour tells me. What you'll need to travel. I'll have someone buy it for you.
Formalities,
Blake coughs. Ah, yes. My pocket again. Terms and conditions of employment. On secondment from Zyshuriton to Neosparin for the duration. More daily remuneration in dollars and value vouchers than I'd see in a week. The fuck? I say. Not at my most professional, although I must have seen this coming.
Formalities.
From Blake. Less cough, more actual word this time. All right.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.